Oh, all right, thanks. Sorry, it's just a little bit of latency on here. All right, so two challenges face Bitcoin right now, privacy and scalability. I don't know if this is, there it is. All right, so in the original Bitcoin white paper, Satoshi Nakamoto noted that all transactions are publicly sent out. So you can look and you can see that Bitcoin identity A paid Bitcoin identity B. But he argued that privacy can still be maintained because someone can not reveal the link between their Bitcoin identity and their true name, their real world identity. But this is this privacy is not often the privacy that people want. For example, there was this great headline in PC World that said that Bitcoin offers privacy as long as you don't cash out or spend it. And there's been a slew of academic research showing how Bitcoin users' privacy can be violated, and you can learn things about people that they wouldn't want to have learned about them. Recently, it was written, an analyst at Citigroup was quoted saying that confidentiality is the key issue holding these things back, referring to Bitcoin and blockchains. That's part of the sticking point for banks. So one thing that we really want to solve is privacy in Bitcoin. We want to make Bitcoin more private. Furthermore, scalability on blockchain scalability is somewhat limited. So Bitcoin transactions can take up to 10 minutes to confirm. And for a Western Union remittance use case, that's perfectly fine. But if you're trying to buy a cup of coffee, you probably don't want to wait 10 minutes for the transaction to confirm. Furthermore, transaction volume. It's been said that Bitcoin can handle about 7 transactions per second maximum with the way that it's currently set up. And if you look at Visa, it's about 2,000 transactions per second average, and it peaks to an order of magnitude higher than that. So we also want to scale Bitcoin. Tumblebit increases privacy and scalability without introducing trust, so no trusted third party. So Tumblebit is a private, untrusted, scalable payment hub, and I'll explain what a payment hub is, that is compatible, i.e. it works with today's Bitcoin. So it's private in that when Alice pays Bob, no one can see that Alice is actually paying Bob. They can see that Alice is paying someone, but they don't know who. It's untrusted in that no one, including the Tumblr, can steal from either party, nor can the Tumblr violate their privacy. It's scalable since it uses a payment hub. It can scale Bitcoin's transaction velocity and volume, and it's compatible in that it works with today's Bitcoin. And compatibility is actually kind of a hard thing to achieve given the limited nature of Bitcoin scripts. So there's two ways to use Tumblebit. The first way is it can be used as a classic Tumblr or Mixer. I'm not going to be talking about that in this talk. I'm going to be talking about the second way, in which Tumblebit is used as a payment hub. So it can make transactions in seconds, and because the payments are off blockchain, they don't hit this max throughput. So you can scale the volume with Tumblebit, and you can scale the velocity with Tumblebit. So how many people here have a general idea of what a payment channel is? All right, so I'm going to give a very brief introduction to payment channels. So Alice has a payment channel with the payment hub, and the payment hub has a payment channel with Bob. The way this works is that Alice has put some bitcoins in a transaction escrow, and moving these bitcoins in this escrow requires both her signature and the payment hub signature. On the other side, the payment hub has put bitcoins in an escrow, and it requires both the payment hub and Bob's signature. So we can use this, Alice can use this to pay Bob. Once the escrows are set up, Alice can produce a transaction, sign this transaction, the payment hub can sign a second transaction, and then with the payment hub and Bob's signatures, the payment can go through, So the payment hub gets one Bitcoin from Alice, and Bob gets one Bitcoin from the payment hub, hence Alice pays Bob through the payment hub. But as I've just described it, there's a problem here, which is that the payment hub could just not pass that transaction on. It gets one Bitcoin, but it doesn't pay one Bitcoin. So there's a traditional solution to this, and the traditional solution is to ensure that claim one and claim two are atomic, so they only happen if they both happen. And the way in which this is done is to use hash locks. Now, the hash lock basically just ensures that there is a shared value between both of these transactions, which has to be learned before both transactions can go through. I won't go into the details of it here. Hash locks have a drawback. So if we have a bunch of payers and we have a bunch of payees and they both have set up payment channels with each other, when they make their payments, you can see, say, Alice 1 paid Bob 2 because their hash locks have the same value. And so this makes it very difficult to have privacy because the payment hub can just inspect the hash locks and see that Alice 1 is paying Bob 2. So the main idea in TumbleBit is to ensure this atomicity, which prevents the payment hub or the tumbler from stealing, while at the same time making the transactions appear to be unlinked. So you can't look at the two transactions and tell that they're atomic, but Alice and Bob can ensure that they are atomic, so the tumbler can't steal by, say, not completing one and allowing the other to complete. So to explain how this works, I need to introduce the notion of RSA puzzles. So an RSA puzzle is just basically encryption. You take a solution, which we call epsilon, and you just encrypt it under your public key. Now note that if no one knows what your secret key is, no one can solve these puzzles but you. So you can give out these puzzles, no one can solve them, and if someone wants to solve them, they have to come to you, and you decrypt them to learn the solution. But RSA has this really neat property called blinding. And blinding can be used to take a puzzle, change it, get a solution for it, and then learn the original solution. So, for example, we have a tumbler, and we have Bob 1 and Bob 2, and the tumbler gives out two different RSA puzzles to Bob 1 and Bob 2. Bob 2 blinds the puzzle, that is, he changes it in a way that it can't be originally recognized, and sends it back to the tumbler as a blinded puzzle. The tumbler can solve this blinded puzzle, send the blinded solution back, the Bob 2 can unblind this blinded solution and get the answer to the original puzzle that he was given, yet the tumbler can't actually learn which puzzle was solved. So the tumbler doesn't know whether this is Bob 1 or Bob 2. So generally, this can be used to build a unlinkable payment hub. So the idea is that we have Alice with a payment channel to the tumbler with a payment channel to Bob. The tumbler says, hey Bob, I'm giving you a puzzle. If you learn the solution to this puzzle, you automatically get one Bitcoin on the blockchain. And the tumbler says to Alice, hey, I'll sell you solutions to RSA puzzles for one Bitcoin. So we can see how this will work, right? Bob will give her puzzle to Alice. Alice will pay to have it solved, and now Bob gets one Bitcoin from that solution. So we have Bob, he learns the solution, he gets a Bitcoin. We have Alice, she trades a Bitcoin for a solution. And Bob makes sure to blind his puzzle before sending it to Alice so the tumbler cannot recognize it when the tumbler provides a solution. It's a little bit more complicated than I've described it, but essentially we have two protocols here that ensure that the tumbler actually does provide a correct solution and that the tumbler constructs the puzzles correctly. So, putting it all together, TumbleBit has three phases. In the first phase, everyone sets up their payment channels. The Bobs get all their puzzles. Once that's set up, we move on to the second phase, in which the payers, the Alices, make a bunch of payments to Bobs. Each time Bob gets a payment, it gains an additional ability to collect a Bitcoin from the escrow. When the payment phase is over, and we imagine this being about 1 month, we have a cash-out phase in which the TumbleBit can take all the payments that have been paid, and the Bobs can collect their money all at once. And so what is And the tumbler sees the aggregate value that each of the bobs gets. So the essentially, the tumbler sees all the payments that Alice made and all the aggregate value, but it so it can't tell which of these five payments from Alice went to which of the bobs. And this is where we get our privacy. So we wrote a proof of concept implementation. It works on today's Bitcoin. We have source code and a development roadmap on GitHub. We're currently working to improve it, make it ready for users. Right now it's a bunch of C++ code. We've tumbled 800 payments in one big tumble on Bitcoin's blockchain. If you check out our paper, you can see these on the blockchain. And our implementation is performant. It doesn't use much bandwidth. It's fairly quick. The biggest issue is the latency, especially when sent over Tor. A payment can take 11 seconds. We think we can get that much lower. But 11 seconds is still certainly less than 10 minutes. So in conclusion, TumbleBit provides a private, untrusted, scalable payments on today's Bitcoin. We have a running code. Our running code is currently the classic Tumblr mode, not the payment channel mode, but they're very similar. The core protocols are the same. And I just want to leave you with one thought. So, a lot of the functionality which TumbleBit has is not directly baked into Bitcoin. It's built at a layer above. And so I think one interesting observation here is that you can actually add new functionality to Bitcoin, even some fairly complex cryptographic functionality, above the consensus layer. When we first actually looked at this project, we had, you know, opcodes that we wanted to add to Bitcoin that would require soft forks. But sometimes soft forks aren't necessary. If with the right crypto, you can sometimes build something which looks like it would need a soft fork, but in fact just increases the functionality above the layer of consensus. So I sort of want to ask, like, what else is possible with these techniques? What sort of things look like they should require a consensus level change, but in fact could be achieved without changing any of the Bitcoin core code base? Thank you, and I'll take questions. Okay.
Hey there, great talk. So basically, you've got a proof of concept now. How far out do you think your technology is from someone being able to roll it into a larger solution and actually deploy it into a real world use case?
So it's to repeat the question, how far away are we away from, say, a user just being able to use TumbleBit in a regular use case?
It's more like if a company wanted to integrate what you're doing into an existing solution that's already doing things at a higher layer like this. Is that the sort of project that you're interested in at this point, or are you really just looking to create a pure just TumbleBit and then escalate from there?
So we're very interested in making TumbleBit modular so that it could be easily integrated into other projects. I think that a lot of the protocols on TumbleBit actually do have interesting utilities in other projects. And so one of the things that we're trying to do right now is to make it modular so you can pull out some of those protocols and use them in other people's products.
Okay, great. Do we have any more questions for Mr. Ethan Heilman? You have, okay, great. Where am I going? Okay, here we go.
You might have mentioned this, but in case you didn't or I missed it, is this compatible with something like Lightning?
So I think parts of it certainly are. The Alice to Tumblr connection could just be a Lightning payment channel. For the ease of description and analysis in our paper, we assume that everything is much simpler unidirectional payment channels. But I do think that there's a lot of potential cooperation between Lightning, where we could use some of their code to make the Alice to Tumblr more efficient. I think we could integrate with Lightning.
All right, thank you, Ethan. This is terrific. We appreciate you joining us today, and I think we're coming back later, so take a seat in front. Good job. Okay, great. We now have our speaker. This is someone you've seen earlier today, and I'm going to give a little bit more context in that he is the co-founder of the BeSafe Network, which is it's neural research test network for blockchain technology. So if you can just wrap your head around all that. And I mean, this is a guy who, I mean, this is Matsuo-san I'm talking about. So he's MIT Media Lab, Keio University, Tokyo University, and a tech advisor to Digital Garage. And his areas of focus include cryptography, blockchain, and information security. So Matsuo-san, would you please come join us and give us a little glimpse into the frontiers of blockchain research.
Okay, so thank you for the introduction. So I'd like to talk about the evaluation of security and how the academic community can help that so the blockchain technology make more secure. Okay, that's a big question about how mature the current blockchain technology is. So Bitcoin protocol is also already used and Bitcoin has already have value. But I think that so many person has so some kind of the blockchain technology is in commercialization phase, and so there are many experimental project in Japan that in any other countries, and but so my opinion is that so we need more research on the to make the blockchain technology secure. The question is also, is the blockchain really secure enough? For example, the proof that there so verify the so security of that the Bitcoin blockchain, but there's no so formal proof was security verification on that, and so there's formal security definitions that fine grade the so technical requirements are there, then they're not sufficient. I will explain later. And there are some persons who say that so blockchain technology is trustless. But I think that this terminology is not in the case. So there are so many layers of security when we construct information systems by using cryptography. So bottom layer is the cryptography itself, and so the next layer is so protocol, which means that so it realizes some functionality using cryptography, and that logic should be implemented into the product, and so we should care about the security of the operation itself. And so when we map these layers to the blockchain technology, so for example, cryptography contains the ECDSS, SHA-2, RIPE-MD, and so on. And the protocol layer contains that so financial transaction P2P consensus. And okay, so we should think about the program code for implementation. And in operation layer, so we should care about the key management, audit, and backupping. So in general, so we can refer that so existing ISO IEC standards for each layer of the security. But so one bad news is so as far as I know, there's no such kind of connection between the so existing ISO IEC standard or other standard to the with the so development of the blockchain technology. Here, so I would like to revisit the case of TLS. So in these 5 years, so we have the many incidents or the vulnerability of TLS protocol, including heartbreak, brutal, wake, and so on. And so that's our main problem, which is the cause of that attacks or vulnerabilities. Okay, so there's no security proof for the TLS protocol, and there's no procedure for verification of the technology in IETF, and there's no experts on the verification of cryptographic protocols in IETF. And there is that the quality of the code of OpenSSL is not sufficient. This is the problem of the TLS, and so this is the reason why we encountered many times of the vulnerability in TLS development. Okay, so the case of the DAO is so a little bit so similar type of problem. So according to the DAO issues, so we had a chance to lose some money, and this is caused by the vulnerability of the code. And at this time, there is no official way of the workaround. And the problem of the DAO issues is an official way of the handling of the vulnerability of the code. And there is no procedure of the workaround. And so there is an over-investment of the certified technology. And so, of course, this is an intersection of that cryptography or technology or under financial incentive. So we need to also think about that. Okay, so I think that so this slide is a little bit old one. I'd like to introduce the current status of the security evaluation of the blockchain technology. There are two types of the methodology to evaluate the security of the protocols. One is a formal verification. The other is mathematical rigorous proof. So formal verification uses some kind of automated tools to evaluate the security of protocol. There's a long history to do verification of the cryptographic protocol. I think that this is a 20 or 30 years history. That kind of methodology is used to check that security of key exchange protocol and authentication protocol. And in this 2 or 3 years, we had several results using formal verification to blockchain technologies. But I think from my perspective, there's only 10% or 20% of the security requirement is now verified. It is not so sufficient. And the other methodology to evaluate the protocol is using some kind of mathematical proof. This is theorem of the security of the protocol, and then so we evaluate the possibility of the attack by using some mathematical methodologies. The good news is last month we had the first academic paper which proved the security of the blockchain technology with proof of stake by using universal composability framework. But so this paper still have the many restrictions. And so we should care about that to overcome that such kind of restriction. And this is the reason why we should doing more research by academia to make that technology more secure. And here, I would like to revisit the history of the internet. So April 13th, 1995 is the day of the commercialization of the internet. But so we would like to note that before that date, so we have the 10 years of that testing the technologies and the period of the maturing that technologies by using research network. This is called NSFnet. NSFnet is some kind of research test network provided founded by NSF. And it took over 10 years to make that technology mature. I think that it's time to do the same thing for blockchain technology. So I and Pinda Wong started a project called bsafe.network. This plays the same role as NSFnet for blockchain technology. This is a so neutral, so stable and sustainable research test network. I think that the neutrality is an important thing here. And so from the social point of view, universities or some kind of academic organization is a neutral place. So we plan to constructing test networks by using the node at international universities only. And each university has become a blockchain node here, and so we establish a research blockchain blockchain networks among the university nodes. And each university can do research on blockchain and its application. This is not limited to security matters. All aspects of the blockchain technology can be tested over this network. Okay, we are now collecting some and so, for example, United Kingdom, Korea, Japan, Hong Kong, Israel, Ghana, United States, and other countries also has more interest in participating in that. And this year is a bootstrapping phase of bsafe.net. And the first seed node of that blockchain, bsafe.net, was established at Keio University, Japan. And so we are now adding university from Asia, Europe, and United States. And we already have six nodes, including MIT, Newcastle University, and other universities in Japan. And we aim to add university to 30 this year. And the first research project we already started is attacking Bitcoin plus segregated witness protocols. And we also adding the Ethereum, Hyperledger, or other kind of blockchain software to be tested over this network. So I'm return to the story of TLS. So this 5 years, we had many troubles with TLS, but TLS 1.3, this is the next version of TLS protocol. So during the process of developing this version, academia are giving many contribution to IETF. And so IETF holds some kind of conference like a Toron. This conference, both academia how we can make this TLS protocol more secured. Academia provided many result of formal verification of the protocol. It finds many problem of that specification of the TLS protocols and some kind of good result of that formal verification. I think that this is evidence of that DLS 1.3 don't have any chance of attack, but that kind of activities make that TLS protocol more secure. We believe that P2P protocol, cryptography, consensus, business logic, and that its implementation to the code can realize a decentralized ecosystem with Bitcoin. But after the DAO attack, we can learn that this is not the case. But academia can add more verification to each technologies or program code. And I think that the help of academia can make the decentralized ecosystem more strong. Thank you very much.
So now we have our final speaker in the frontiers of blockchain, and he's a PhD student at Stanford, and his research specifically applies to cryptography and applied security. I will leave him a bit of a mystery so that he can fill in his own portraiture, Benedikt Bünz. Please join us on stage. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. So one of the ways to measure how innovative Bitcoin was when it first came out is that it not only like jumped to the top of existing categories, it really created a bunch of new categories. It's a, like, you could argue that it's the first functional and working digital currency, or fully digital currency. It's definitely the first fully decentralized currency, but it's also the first working cryptocurrency. And my talk today is going to be about that aspect, and about the fact that Bitcoin and these other cryptocurrencies, being a cryptocurrency, they allow us to apply these interesting tools from cryptography to do cool new stuff that would just simply not be possible in a standard fiat currency. And the specific thing that I'm going to talk about is how can we do these so-called proofs of solvencies for Bitcoin exchanges to make these exchanges more secure. And this is joint work from Concordia University in Canada, Stanford University, and EFF. So, most users, when they use Bitcoin, the majority, I would say, they don't install Bitcoin on their own computer. We saw earlier how that is a rather lengthy process to run a full node. A lot of people use Bitcoin through exchanges because it is actually very hard to secure Bitcoins on your own computer, and people trust an exchange more to secure the Bitcoin for them. And this is just, you might like that or not, but this is just simply the reality. And you can kind of think of these exchanges as banks. They don't really like to be called banks, maybe for political reasons, but they, and regulation reasons, but they look a lot like banks. The problem with the Bitcoin exchanges is that they have an extremely shaky track record. So there was the famous Mt. Gox crash. For a long time, there was this insecurity whether Bitcoin was solvent or not, and there were actually protesters outside of Mt. Gox. I would say it has probably gotten better, but there was a study in 2013 that estimated at that point in time 50% of Bitcoin exchanges that had ever come to existence were just simply not there anymore. Not all of them like ran away with the money, but unfortunately, and Mt. Gox, for example, also did. So, what is the goal that we're trying to solve with our new protocol? The goal is to allow these exchanges to prove that they're solvent. So the question is, so they have a bunch of customers. Each customer has claims that they has some money at the exchange, some Bitcoin at the exchange, and the sum of those addresses and the sum of the money at those Bitcoin addresses are the total assets. And solvency is basically just saying that the sum of the assets should be greater than the sum of the liabilities. We don't really want exchanges to run a fractional reserve, although real banks do that. But what we want is to prove that these exchanges should prove to the customers that they are actually solvent, that they have a full reserve. So how can we do that? The simplest approach is just to open their books. They say, okay, these are my customers, that's the balances that they have. These are my addresses, here I can prove that I can control them. But obviously that's terrible from a privacy point of view, and I don't think any exchange has ever done that or would be willing to do that, and users would not be happy with having their balances open. The other and says, yeah, looks good to me, and like you have to then trust that auditor, of course, and what if the auditor colludes with the exchange, then that's a problem as well. And actually Mt. Gox had an auditor, but they had someone looking over their books and saying everything was okay, but in the end that did not turn out to be the case. Maybe it was okay at that point in time, I don't wanna. So the first kind of more cryptographic solution came from Greg Maxwell in 2013, and I'm not going to explain the protocol, but it's using something called a Merkle tree, and it basically hides the balances for the users. So the users' balances do not have to be made public anymore. So, but you can still see how much are the total liabilities of the exchange to its customers in the end. But that's the main thing you learn. The problem is we then need the other side of the proof, so you need to prove how many assets they have, and the only way that could be done before our protocol is just to do a big transaction on the blockchain, and Bitstamp actually did that. So they transferred $147 million worth of Bitcoin on the blockchain to prove that they possess them. So other exchanges, though, have said that this protocol is too leaky and they're not going to run it because they don't want to reveal how many assets they have in total. That's a pretty big business secret. So that's how we came about and decided to design a new protocol that does not reveal anything, basically. It doesn't reveal the total liabilities. It doesn't reveal any information about how much each account has, which Bitcoin addresses the exchange controls. So that seems kind of, when you first see that, and then you might think, okay, how is that possible? How can we even conceptually do that? So crypto comes to the rescue here with this very fascinating tool called zero knowledge proofs of knowledge. So that's a very interesting name in my opinion, so I'm gonna try to explain what that means. So a zero knowledge proof of knowledge is a so-called cryptographic proof that the prover knows the solution to an equation, but it does not reveal the solution of the equation. So I can prove to you that I know a solution of a complicated equation that you cannot solve yourself, but I'm not going to tell you anything about what the solution actually is. But afterwards, you're still going to be convinced that I know the solution. And it relies on this other cryptographic tool, which are so-called commitments. So I can commit to a number, say, like, I can commit to the number 42, and you can not see that it's a commitment to 42, but I can then afterwards open it, but I can only open it to be 42. So it's so-called hiding and binding. It hides the value, but it binds me to only be able to open it to the number that I committed to. So what are some of the statements that I can prove? So I can prove the classic one is the so-called, like, I can prove that I know the discrete logarithm of a number. So say G, Y, and P are public, but then I can make the statement, I can prove that I know an X such that G to the X equals Y mod P. But nothing about X will be revealed, but you will be convinced that I know X. And we can do more interesting things. This is actually kind of, if you write this up in math, this is the same statement because I can prove that I know the private key to a Bitcoin address without revealing what the private key is. Or we can do some crazy things. We can say, I know the private keys that have unspent coins at the corresponding addresses, and TX is a hiding commitment to outputs of a transaction such that the sum of the spent coins is less than the sum of the input coins. Okay, so this is the one sentence explanation of what Zcash is, which has been released, I think, exactly a week ago. And Zcash is basically, it's a so-called altcoin, and it allows transactions to be fully anonymous. So no one can see, you can see these transactions, but the transactions are basically just these large, or these complicated zero knowledge proofs, and all you know that, okay, the coins that went from A to B were actually unspent before, but you don't know who is sending to who and how much money, and all of that is completely hidden. And this uses basically the same tools or similar tools to what we use in our protocol. So protocols, we have our proof of liabilities, which gives us then a commitment to the liabilities. So that is hiding again. We have the proof of assets, which gives me a commitment to our assets. And then we combine, basically say we make a proof that we're solvent, so that the commitment of the assets is greater than the commitment of the liabilities, or it's zero. So how does the proof of liabilities work? So, there's something missing there. But so every user gets, the exchange makes a commitment to the balance of each customer. And then every user has to check that they were actually included, that their balance is included. And then we make these two zero knowledge proofs. The first one is that we're making basically the sum of all the balances, and then we get a commitment to the liabilities. But that, again, all zero knowledge, nothing is revealed here. And the second one is, so we have to prevent that someone is, that the exchange is adding negative fake accounts with negative balances, so we have to prove that every balance is actually a positive number. Surprisingly, this takes up most of the space of the proof of the whole protocol. But the other side of the protocol is the proof of assets. So what we're going to do here is we're going to take a large anonymity set. So this can be, for example, all addresses on the blockchain that have some money and, on it, you would probably cut away the dust addresses. But basically, you say, okay, I know the private key to for a subset of the Bitcoin addresses, such that the total value of the Bitcoin that are at these addresses is committed to by this number Z assets. Okay, so again, a fairly complicated statement, but it is possible to prove this in zero knowledge. But we basically then say, like, okay, you don't know which addresses I control, but you do know that whatever this commitment is, it is the sum of the it is the sum of the balances of the addresses where I do know the private keys. So knowing the private keys means I control the Bitcoin at these addresses, and the final commitment Z assets that comes out of this proof is going to be only the sum over those things, not the sum over the addresses which I do not know the private keys to. So. Then when we go to the overall picture, the thing that is left is we have now a commitment to the liabilities, we have a commitment to the assets, so we're going to do the proof of solvency, and that is basically just a zero knowledge proof that the commitment to the assets is greater or equal to the commitment of the balances. So proof of solvencies do have limitations. So a proof of solvency is a snapshot. You take a snapshot of the blockchain and say, okay, I'm going to do a proof of solvency at this point in time. So you know that the exchange was solvent at this point in time. Nothing prevents it from losing all their private keys the next second, or running away with the money, or transferring it away. The second thing, and that is, I think that is a conceptual problem with proof of solvency. I don't think, or we have not figured out a way to solve that, because it seems like such a conceptual problem that it is a snapshot. And also, proof of solvency means that I have enough money to pay out. It does not imply that I'm willing to pay out. So, obviously, I could just never, like, when people start doing a bank run or requesting their money back, I could just say, okay, I'm not going to fly. I'm not going to pay you out. But we hope that that proof of solvency still have a value and that they can build trust in these Bitcoin exchanges. And frankly, the problem is if users are not willing to control their own private keys, if they give up that trust, then this really seems the best that we can do. So in summary, proofs of solvency are possible. They're possible with cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin. They're not possible with fiat currency. For any normal bank, it would be nice to have a proof of solvency. The only model that we have right now is that you kind of trust that the number that your bank shows you in your e-banking is actually that they're actually willing to pay you out and that you can go to the ATM and get cash for it. And I mean, there have been, and the problem with banks is that we actually know that they're running a fractional reserve. So there have been there have been scenarios where banks have stopped paying out, and I think in Cyprus, there was a point where people could, and Greece, like people could at some point just not access their money anymore. So this is really something, I find this fascinating because it really shows you where, it's one of those many examples where we can do, where we have a problem that would exist with fiat currency, but only with cryptocurrency we can really solve it. And another thing that I would say is that cryptocurrencies, part of research, and I think we're maybe going to talk about that in the panel, but part of the research is focused on saying, okay, is Bitcoin actually secure? Can we kind of, are there things that are insecure that need to be improved? Can we analyze it? But also there's another area of research, I think, surrounding cryptocurrencies, which is more about, okay, how can we take the existing tools that we have, or how can we use cryptocurrency as a, how can we use the blockchain or cryptocurrencies as a new tool to build new and exciting things? So, and I think both of these things are extremely important. And yeah, thank you very much. So, if you have questions.
Thank you, Benedikt. Okay, so one of the benefits of attending today is that people like Benedikt break down what a zero-knowledge proof is in ways that even I can understand. And so I'm very grateful that complex concepts that apply to blockchain have been broken down and disseminated today. So in that spirit, we're gathering up for our last panel. These people are sitting on top of the bleeding edge, and it probably hurts them, but it's for our benefit. So I'm going to invite our last round of folks up here. We've got Benedikt is already on stage. Shin'ichiro-san, let's get you up here. Ethan, get you back up here. And Elizabeth, let's be moderated. Do you need a microphone? Why don't I give you this one? Come on up, please. Enjoy.
Hey, everybody. Great to be back up here. Is this working okay? So we've just heard three talks from esteemed academic researchers about the work that they've been doing. And the first question I'd like to start off with here is, so you've all been at your respective institutions working on Bitcoin-related research. Some in the community believe that there's a gap between, say, the development community and then what's going on in academia. Do you believe that there is one? And if so, how can we, you know, ensure that there isn't much of one?
Sure. So I think that there is a gap. I don't know if the gap is more or less than other projects, like, say, TLS or... you know, even like hard drive encryption, researchers tend to focus on doing novel work rather than often fixing things that are broken. And doing development can be a like extremely time consuming. So I'm actually like fairly optimistic. I think that the academic community and the developers have actually done sort of better than some other groups. I do think more can be done, but I think, like using myself as an example, the fact that the developers, when I've contacted them with stuff, have been very willing to talk to me, to integrate in changes. I think some of that is that I often work on stuff that is not in the core consensus, and so to get code in there, it's much easier if you're not proposed or changes that would require a soft fork. So maybe on the academic side, the academics could, if they want more immediate results in the code, potentially working on things like the peer-to-peer network or layer two solutions like Lightning.
Yeah. So I think, right, like, for example, your work is a great example of where maybe at some research or at like an earlier stage in research is stage in time, people would just say like, okay, well, we can't do that in Bitcoin, let's just do an altcoin, or like let's just create something different. And I think there are very exciting developments in that area. I mean, Zcash started as a research project and is extremely innovative, and I think it's impressive what they've done. But I think it's also I think sometimes academia needs to be more accept basically Bitcoin as a given and work within the constraints and not just say like, okay, this doesn't work well, I'm just going to go on and like solve this problem in this idealized settings where I have, for example, all the opcodes. And right, like you said in your research, you thought in the beginning, okay, well, this could work if we have all these, this thing. But then in the end, it's actually kind of a neat solution if you can make it work. It's an extra challenge, and it's very cool if you can make it work with the existing constraints. And yeah.
So I would like to give this another perspective. Okay, let's recall that the first financial cryptographic conference was held in 1997. And the late 19th is the first age of the electric digital cash. And at that time, so there are many sort of experimental of the digital cash was held. For example, there are some projects in Japan or in UK, or there are many projects. And at that time, so many research scientists joined that experiment, and they have much knowledge about that. So cryptography was how we can make a secure digital cash protocol and so on. But the bad news is that the guy who involved in the digital cash project is currently 45 or 50 years old at this time, and they are so top level guy at this time, and they have much knowledge, but also that kind of knowledge is not transformed to the young people at this time. This kind of the gap of the knowledge is a more problematic thing. I think that they have not much knowledge to help that current Bitcoin and blockchain technology. And so we should transfer that old but useful knowledge to current young person.
That's a great transition to my next question. So I'm curious, as academic researchers, how did you personally get interested in the blockchain space? And then as a second part, how can we get more researchers interested as well?
I can start. So I think I got interested in, so I first learned about Bitcoin in like 2011 and just some newspaper article and started playing around with it without knowing much. And then actually later on, this kind of led me to an interest in cryptography. So it was, for me, it was actually the Bitcoin was first, and then my interest in cryptography and security kind of arose from that. And I saw the opportunity, or that, like, that I'm very interested in both things, both Bitcoin and cryptography as the more fundamental ideas. And I think that is, yeah, maybe right, like this is the kind of, like you're saying, like now the younger generation, right, is there more people like that who first learned about Bitcoin and who so for example, there's a Bitcoin class at Stanford, and I think the professor who teaches is Dan Bonet. He says like one of the things that excites him more about Bitcoin, like besides the technology, is that it really is a great tool to get people excited about cryptography and excited about security. And so that's kind of what happened for me. And now they're teaching the class at Stanford, and I think lots of undergrads are interested and learn about Bitcoin. And
you were involved in teaching this class, right?
Yeah. So I'm not a teacher, but my two co-authors, Joe Bonneau and Dan Bonet, are the official teachers, and I was teaching it and helping, like building it up. And yeah, it's a really cool class, and the students were, I think the feedback was very, very positive.
Are the materials online for the class? Can the audience check it out?
So the p-sets and some of the materials are online at I think cs251.stanford.edu, and it's based on the class is based on a course book which was also partially written by Joe, and you find the link to that on that page.
The Princeton
book? Yeah, it was written by a group at Princeton, and yeah.
Okay, I would like to explain the current situation in Japan. So in Japan, there are many large number of the research scientists in cryptography. I think that some part of them would like to sort of dive in this world. My current role is to connect such kind of cryptographer in Japan to this area. But so the bad news in Japan is there is a few number of research scientists in P2P network or distributed computing. So we need to add more research scientists in this area. This is the current situation in Japan. And so my current activity is connecting the Japanese cryptographer into this area, and encourage to add more research scientists in P2P or distributed computing area.
Ethan.
So I was very interested in eCash a while ago, and so when I saw the Bitcoin paper came out, I was at a startup, and I was like, oh. And I was a big fan of it. And when I moved on to grad school, I was always just like, you know, this is amazing. There's this whole Bitcoin thing, and we can solve all of these problems. problems. So ended up getting some blockchain type things into some earlier research, and then got a chance to work on Bitcoin. I think like your comments, it's a great way to get people excited about crypto. We teach
Allison, Bob, and Mallory. Yeah,
definitely.
Mallory's dangerous.
So
we have a name for Bitcoin, like Bitcoin user. Like Bob is just A and B, but like we should have like.
Yeah, we need to make our own vernacular.
Satoshi.
Okay, Satoshi.
But like. It's an awesome way to introduce like digital signatures and hash functions and Merkle trees, and also like people really get excited about Bitcoin. Like it's, you know, you can come up with some scenario where someone's trying to communicate to someone else, but like Bitcoin is just so cool. So we get an enormous amount of interest from undergraduates, and they're like really excited to like work on it. And the fact that there's a code base which they can just like look at and read C++ and sort of like play around with is I think really, really positive.
So Ethan, you presented in Milan at Scaling Bitcoin with a collaborator of yours, who I believe she's an undergrad at BU.
Yeah.
How did she get involved in the project?
We had a undergraduate research opportunity, and she applied for it, and we like sent her, like we basically send out this like task to see how quick someone can do it, and she did it extremely quickly, and then we brought her in, and then she was explaining things. I think like in a week she was telling me, like when I would have questions I'd go to her because she like really understood it well. I was still trying to, I hadn't looked at pay to script hash, and I was like trying to look at it, and I like couldn't quite figure out how it worked, because it's a little bit different than like output scripts and input scripts. It has the whole redeem script. And then I was like, how does this work? And like,
the fun thing about new technology is sometimes the younger students are the ones teaching the researchers.
Yeah, right? It's so easy to hit the ground running with Bitcoin, because it's not like something that there is all of, you know, in some areas of cryptography, people have been looking at it for a really long time, which can be somewhat intimidating. But with a lot of the stuff, like we're all beginners at Bitcoin, right? There's no one that was, or
nobody's
maybe Satoshi.
Nobody's been a decade-long expert except perhaps Satoshi. So another question is, so you've each presented, you know, your projects, Tumblebit, Be Safe, and Provisions, respectively. What are the next steps? Are you planning on, you know, you mentioned a bit of implementation, you know, expansion. You know, what does the next year look like for your particular academic projects?
Okay, so I would like to talk about the Be Safe. So as I sort of explained at the speech, so this year, so I would like to expand the number of nodes to 30, but next year, so I would like to add some organization to extend the number of nodes, for example, 100, 200, and we need some good organization to do research over the BCF. And so my dream, or so my intention is also extending bsafe.network to the possibly some standardization organization like ITF or some kind of thing.
This so you want to extend it outside of the universities, perhaps?
So bsafe.network is also some kind of a platform which also developer and both developer and research scientist is act as some kind of project. And this is also this can be a source of knowledge derived from the academia, and so that so research result over the BSafe network is also become a source of that further standard, so some kind of technology standard. This is also our plan for the future of the BSafe network.
So I think we're gonna. Currently, it's a proof of concept. Tumblebit is fairly rough. It works, but it's not ready for user adoption. I very much like it when people use things that I made. So I think like we're gonna like come together and try to like build it out and get it in. Get it to users, and also as there was a question that was asked. Hopefully, like we can make some efforts so that other people can also use it in their project. So I think there's going to be a lot of development time ahead.
Yeah. And you're hiring folks to work on the project, right? I saw.
Yeah, we're looking. We're looking for one software engineer that we can bring on for like 6 to 12 months.
Is there any engineers out there want to work on TumbleBit?
Yeah. Benedikt. So, in terms of provision, one of the things that unfortunately has not happened, and that we're talking to some exchanges, but I mean, I really want to have it deployed and running, and I think what will happen is once one exchange implements it, all the others have to follow, because people are going to be asking, okay, well, exchange A is doing a proof of solvency, why are you not? Okay, this, I'll rather be at exchange A where I know that my bitcoins are safe. So there's some still some technical challenges with, for example, multi-signature addresses and the kinds of and like special kinds of addresses and page script hash addresses that make the protocol a little bit more complicated. But I think I really want to see it deployed in public, and I really think it really takes one exchange, and then I hope that all the others will have to follow.
Is there a website for the project?
Yeah, there's GitHub code, which is in the slides, and I think the slides will be online.
And so just go to the GitHub and you'll find that.
Yes,
you'll,
yeah. But if there are any representatives of exchanges here, I don't know, and you are thinking about implementing this, please come afterwards and talk to me, and I would be happy to help, and I really want to see this deployed in public.
All right, so in doing your academic research, I know things have progressed quite a bit in the last few years, but I'm curious if you face any resistance. And then also, what have the challenges been in terms of, you know, pursuing this work? And that's a very broad question, but you guys can answer it however you want.
So I certainly haven't faced any resistance. I know it seems like everyone's just sort of like excited about Bitcoin in general, and the fact that the like Bitcoin devs are so sort of like open just seems to have like also magnified, like, you know, you put an effort and then you get more like energy out, and it just sort of makes things like easier and makes it an easier case to sell. But I think that there's just so much like excitement about Bitcoin. I think it's been
I'm excited just listening to you.
So I faced one problem. So to process the BCF.net project. So BCF.net project, so we asked to each university to become one blockchain node. But so this means that the blockchain nodes are communicated by using P2P protocol, but some universities prohibit using that SAT port or P2P communications. This is due to the policy of the network administration. This is one problem, but so we should say that that kind of test network is good things than the existing the P2P thing, but so this is currently there is some restriction in some universities doing research on the blockchain or P2P based protocol.
Yeah. And have you worked with them to try to overcome that challenge and make the argument to whatever authority that this is worth it?
I'm trying to make a new great example to explain the merit of the doing that kind of research for universities.
Yeah, so I think one like slightly different form of resistance is something that has been talked about before today at this conference. It does take a while to really get up to speed with everything. For example, I really did not have, in the beginning I knew about Bitcoin, but as I said, I didn't have a cryptographic a background knowing about cryptography, and it's been very exciting, very rewarding to learn about all of that with kind of Bitcoin in mind as a concept, but it is complicated stuff like that's, and I think we've talked about today about multiple ways in which it is It is a challenge to get up to speed with everything, but I feel like it's definitely been worth it. And it is also definitely possible. And the other thing that I think the one of the things that we've talked about, for example, at the Scaling Bitcoin conference, it's not really resistance, but the it would be nice to have a clearer view on what the developers, for example, see as like big open research problems and kind of have a clear so that people are not talking like working in different directions and but that, for example, researchers can state like, okay, this is a really like a conceptual problem, not just an implementation problem, but something where some research would be very helpful and
kind of like a call for research from the development community to say, like, hey, academics, here's you know what we could
we talked about Bitcoin. There's like the Bitcoin improvement proposals, the BIPs, kind of Bitcoin research proposals. Yeah. I think that like we were all three of us
on something similar.
Yes,
all three of us were in at Scaling Bitcoin
at Scaling Bitcoin. So we had some workshop regarding to the collaboration between the developers community and the academy. And we had a good discussion at that workshop. And developer community proposed that they would propose some Bitcoin research requests over the developer mailing list. Of course, research community don't have the obligation to respond that, but this is a good proposal. From the academy point of view, so we can find the new research topics from that BR Bitcoin research request, and I think that kind of trial will make a good relationship between the developer community and the research community. And this is good to communicate too.
Yeah. I think one other form of resistance hasn't been, not in my personal experience, but I think the problem is that I wouldn't say the people who are actually doing something with Bitcoin, but there are people in the Bitcoin space who are very religious about it. And I think part of that stems from the fact that people have made and lost Yeah, and people have made and lost a lot of money and then invested a lot of money, and that kind of leads to weird incentives. So for example, there was some interesting research done at Cornell on some weaknesses in the consensus protocol, and I think there was a lot of, I mean, it's the internet, people I mean on the internet, but there's like always a lot of angry backlash. And
take Jeremy Rubin's advice and don't go to Reddit.
Don't go to Reddit, yeah. Or just go to reddit.com/r/aww, that's, and look at happy cat pictures, yep.
Cute cat. The academic world. So, Benedikt, I know you collaborated with people from Concordia in Canada. Clearly, you know, Matsuo-san, you're trying to get everyone working together, and I'd like be curious to hear if you've done more collaboration, but do you find that there are more and more opportunities, and if so, how are you going to go about, you know, finding colleagues from other universities to do research with?
So, I don't think I've collaborated. Like, a lot of the research has been very much within BUSEC, although many of the people from BUSEC have moved to other universities. So I'm probably not a good person to answer that question.
Maybe you're open to it in the future.
Yeah, no, I'm totally open to collaboration. Like, it's a good thing, but for the most part, it's just we have a group there, and so we've just been like working among ourselves. But it's also, you know, many of the postdocs have gone on to professorships, so it's like, yeah. I think that the group has spread out, so there probably will be more collaboration.
Yeah, I think, right, like, collaboration is important in all of academia, and I think what these kind of conferences, like Scaling Bitcoin, when you see each other at security or cryptography conferences, but also...
Quick shout out for Byron Gibson's event at Stanford in January, which will be a great opportunity for this. Yeah. Security in the blockchain.
Google, I think it's like Stanford Blockchain Security Conference Workshop, something like that, and you might find it. The other thing is, I think, right, like, kind of as you said, like, now the first generation of, like, PhDs has... they've graduated and moved on to professorships, and that kind of spreads around the people, and people still work with their old universities, and I think that's going to help collaboration. But I think with any collaboration, the most important thing is that you actually meet the people in person, and then it just, like, once you've met someone in person, it's much easier to then, like, talk over Skype, and so I think we're on a good path.
And I would like to add one more news, sir. So May 2017, so there is more one good conference held by IEEE S&B. Okay. This will be held the day before the Eurocrypt. Right. And so currently, so we are holding the call for papers. Deadline is also December 4th, I think. And the good news is that such kind of good academic conference, there are many conferences. I think that this kind of things gives more incentive to university research scientists. So in general, so university research scientists tend to do research which can be become a high quality papers. So before that scaling Bitcoin, there is no such kind of conference or journals, and this discourages academic person to do research or writing paper. But this is the good news is that we have so many such kind of good conference now. This is a good thing.
So my understanding is there's a university in Switzerland, ETH, that offers a PhD in Bitcoin, because I know some people that are getting PhDs or some people that have gotten PhDs in Bitcoin. Should all universities offer a PhD or other degrees in Bitcoin?
PhDs or degrees? I don't know, right?
Like, or other degrees.
It's interesting, yeah, maybe, right? Like, so the thing that one of the fascinating things about Bitcoin from a research point of view is that really you have to, it combines not only cryptography and security, but also the thing that secures Bitcoin or blockchains is game theory and economics, and yeah, obviously it's money, it's finance. So you have all these different fields. I think this, I don't know if a new degree is necessary, but I think kind of in light of collaboration, like I hope that it's going to lead to collaboration from the economics departments with computer science departments, and also, I mean, we're talking today about the social impact, the sociology and other departments, and it's, I think, it's great because it really combines many areas of science. And
have you worked with, say, the economics department or folks at Stanford?
Not at Stanford specifically, but I've done stuff in kind of computation and economics, and I definitely do want to continue that and kind of think about, like, maybe what I would like to see is a more rigorous analysis of the economic incentives of Bitcoin, that kind of give us more trust that, and also a model, what happens if things change, what happens if the block reward goes down, what will that do to the incentives, because this is really one of the innovations about Bitcoin, is that if the incentives fail, then Bitcoin is not going to be secure anymore. And if
there was a recent Princeton paper.
Yeah, on exactly that, on what happens when the block reward, and that is, to me, that is still very much unclear to see whether Bitcoin will still be secure when that happens, and I think we should definitely think about that now.
Yes, so as you know, so MIT Media Lab is so anti-disciplinary organization, and so DCI, so great news is, so in the DCI,
so by the way, can I go to the Simon, lab and get my PhD in Bitcoin?
I don't know, but DCI is so MIT, so institution-wide project, not limited to the Media Lab. So in the DCI, there are many PhD students at the CSL, or there are many students at MIT Sloan. It's a successful project to gather many kind of background, and PhD person from CSL, student in economics from Sloan, whereas there are many master course or PhD student in the Media Lab. I think that this is also one good example to have so multiple background in one place.
So I certainly agree with everyone that Bitcoin cuts across all these different fields. I don't know if a degree program that's just on Bitcoin is the right way to approach that or not. But I do think that building structures like the DCI that enable that collaboration is very important. And I often think about how computer science actually combines very different thoughts from like something like software engineering to, you know, topics which are essentially advanced math. So I don't know the right way to like slice it, but I think probably the DCI is onto the right approach.
Do either of your universities have research centers similar to the DCI?
No, not yet. It's
sounds like a project.
Sounds like a project, yeah.
I mean, I visit the DCI from time to time, so.
You're across the river? So
yeah, they're right across the river, so.
I'm not sure about that. At this time, Cornell University has some project, IC3.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, Cornell, right.
Yeah.
The IC3. All right, let's open it up to questions from the audience. Yes. Do we have a mic out there?
Swift, thank you. So one of the kind of hot topics in the Bitcoin world, especially, is this, you know, this question of you know, scaling on-chain transactions. I'm wondering, are there any kind of comprehensive academic research programs that are studying and comparing the trade-offs of the various proposals for on-chain scaling, whether it be, you know, raising the block size or some other mechanics?
I think Ethan is just so right person to answer that.
So I know that there was a paper that came out, I believe it was at FC, that was scaling was it, I forget the name of the paper. The last part of the paper was a position paper, in which they specifically like looked at that question.
It had a lot of authors, right? It had like,
right, yeah,
a million authors. No,
so in terms of collaboration, it was like, you know, across many different schools looking at this question and trying to organize the issue. I don't know of any program, and it might just be because I don't know of it, it might exist, that is specifically looking at that as a program-wide, but we have had instances in which like many different researchers have come together to publish a program to look at the various trade-offs on on-chain scaling.
Also check out Arthur Gervais, who I believe is getting his PhD in Bitcoin, gave a talk at Scaling Bitcoin in Milan that's related to this as well.
Matsuo-san, is this something that maybe be safe with your node network would be interested in looking at, is comparing like block propagation times across various internet connections and how this might affect centralization in the networks or anything like that? Have you guys considered that?
Okay, so I think that so what you say is so good research topics, but so at this time so just research topics over business network is not limited to the specific one. So any kind of so research topics regarding the blockchain technology is welcome. For example, so consensus algorithm, P2P propagation, and so on. So any university can make a new research project over business network. So this kind of research topics are also welcome.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you.
Other questions?
Please introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Adam. I'm just an interested businessman, so that probably frames the context. No ideology at all. So I'm just asking all of you as Bitcoin researchers and blockchain experts, do you see a future where, for example, fiat currencies are issued on a blockchain, And if so, is that going to be somehow related to Bitcoin, or is are we going to be living in a world where essentially, we're all going to be trading in Bitcoin?
So
fun question.
So I think, right, like the term blockchain technologies and private blockchains, it's super hot right now, and I think people really need to understand what blockchain does, what it is good for and what it's not. So will we see, so the thing is, the main innovation of the blockchain is that it provides a way to have consensus between parties that don't trust each other and where there's no central authority. In fiat currencies, you kind of inherently have this one central party, the central bank. So you can definitely make a cryptographic currency, make a digital currency, but I don't think that if everybody has to trust the Fed or the central bank anyway, then a blockchain approach, that's just simply an overkill, because you have to trust the Fed anyway. But I think there is innovation out there. I think there's, for example, RS coin, which looks at exactly this problem of how would a central bank, for example, create a digital currency and create a cryptocurrency.
So as far as I know, so for example, so Bank of England, so Singapore as a nation's plan to think about that, so issuing fiat money over blockchain. Mm-hmm. But so many depends on how they think about the cross-border transaction or the cross-border trading. But so at this time, so they are now thinking about that as a possibility of issuing fiat money, and I think that it takes 3 or 4 years to decide their attitude.
So I think in terms of a nation doing something like Bitcoin or adopting Bitcoin for something like a currency or like a token system, making predictions is always dangerous, so I won't do that. But I do think that one of the really valuable properties of something like Bitcoin is that it provides this very simple framework where different organizations can come together without trusting each other. And so I could definitely see the potential for a nation that has multiple like transit systems that are in some private, some public, where like none of them would really like agree to put the other ones in charge of it, and no one would really want the government to be in charge of it. They might say adopt a cryptocurrency as a way of like moving those tokens around, so someone can like buy tokens for the bus, and then when they get to the train station, they can use that same card to jump across to the train station. So I think that the federation aspect of cryptocurrencies could be very valuable for solving some of those sorts of problems.
Yeah, I think that we should think about two separate things. One is so fiat money based economy, and so the other is an economy based on the non-fiat money. So, for example, so salary or so paying rent, such kind of thing, we need so fiat dollar or fiat currency. But so, for example, so exchanging goods or something, some other things, we do not need to using the fiat currency. I think that using the blockchain or using Bitcoin or using the other blockchain-based currency, so it can create a non-fiat money economy. This is my opinion.
I wonder, right, like the question is also, this gets really into political stuff, but whether in the end countries want to, they currently have a monopoly on printing money, and whether they have any incentives to give that up. But
of course, right, of course, there's a big question.
Yes.
Closing question. So if I'm an academic researcher and I want to get started and get involved, what should I do?
So I think maybe if you're, especially if you're first a student, right, before you become an academic researcher, you're a student. So I think one of the things that, so for example, there's a Coursera class on Bitcoin. If at your university a Bitcoin class is offered, you should take that. And if not, then there's the Coursera class, which is very good. And I think, from that on, try to go, I think, There was a list up earlier, like read, go to the conference.
Jeremy Rubin's reading
list. Yeah, Jeremy Rubin's reading list.
Get that.
Yeah, and especially the last part was like was a couple conferences, like CCS, Financial Crypto, and especially in the last few years, there have been a lot of papers on Bitcoin and just reading those and seeing like what kind of problems are still open, what can be built upon that, I think is a great starting point.
And I think that exporting the education program in Stanford or MIT to the other countries is one interesting idea to serve as potential research scientist or potential engineer, make more big, so the community make more big. Exporting, I think that there's some classes in Stanford for Bitcoin, and so some classes in Bitcoin at MIT, and so exporting and exchanging the contents of that course, and exporting the other country is also good idea.
I mean, I think the Coursera class is, it's the model for the class at Stanford, and it's the, I think it's from Princeton, again, like the research book.
Ethan, last word.
So I just sort of want to pitch financial crypto. I went there when I was fairly early in my PhD program, and there's just a large number of people from the Bitcoin community go there, scaling Bitcoins as well. And I think just being like a part of those conversations and being able to ask questions of like human beings, like I learn much more from interacting with a person than reading things often. I can go off and then I can like, you know, follow up those leads. But I think just like going to a conference like Financial Crypto or Scaling Bitcoin.
And I believe it's in Malta
helpful.
This year, correct?
It is, yes.
Not a good reason to go.
The Bitcoin workshop especially, if someone's excited about Bitcoin.
All right, let's thank our panel, academic researchers in Bitcoin.